of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. My salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones that nailed him to that tree. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full, by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full, by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. See, the stone was rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised, he's risen from the grave. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, and honor unto thee, praise and honor unto thee, praise and honor unto thee. Rejoice in the Lord.
Well, good evening and welcome again to Grange Baptist Church. And we trust that wherever you're joining us from, that you'll know the blessing of the Lord, even as we fellowship together around his word. We're coming to consider another group of three men this evening. And we've already, of course, mentioned that it will be the characters of Peter, James and John. And so we're turning in our Bibles to Matthew's Gospel and the chapter 17. And we'll also take a reading from Mark's Gospel and the chapter 9. Matthew's Gospel in the chapter 17, and then also Mark's Gospel and the chapter 9. And let's read together from the verse 1 of Matthew's Gospel as we begin. And the Word of God says, "And after 6 days Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John his brother, and bringeth them up into an high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise, and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. His disciples asked him, saying, Why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say unto you that Elias is come already, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. And then coming across to Mark's Gospel in the chapter 9, we read together in the verse 1, He said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here that shall not taste of death, until they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. And after 6 days Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into an high mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. And his raiment became shining, exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. For he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And suddenly when they had looked round about, they saw no man any more, save Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen, till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one with another what the rising from the dead should mean. And they asked him, saying, Why say the scribes that Elias must first come? And he answered and said unto them, Elias verily cometh first and restoreth all things. And how it is written of the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be set at naught. But I say unto you that Elias is indeed come, and they have done unto him whatsoever they listed, as it is written of him. Amen. And may we know the blessing of the Lord even in the reading of his word. Once again. And so this evening we come to consider these three characters, Peter, James, and John, being, of course, three of the 12 disciples who followed the Lord Jesus Christ everywhere he went during the days of his earthly ministry. And so we come to consider, first of all, the characters of the three men, and indeed shine a spotlight just upon them as individuals, and then we come to consider the events that we've read together as they know what it is to spend that time upon the mount that we commonly refer to as that of transfiguration with the Lord Jesus Christ himself. The first character is, of course, Peter. And he is one whom the Lord himself gave a name to as the rock. He said, Upon this rock I shall build my church. And Peter is considered by many, of course, to be the de facto leader amongst the disciples. He it is who is the most prominent. He seems to articulate their thoughts, even in conversation with the Lord Jesus Christ. And then, as well, he appears to be their spokesman to others also, especially in the days, the early days of the New Testament church after the Lord has ascended to be with his Father. He was, as well, the dominant preacher. And we'll come to consider that in just a few moments. But the Bible records to us that he was the son of Jonas. And whenever he was introduced to the Lord Jesus Christ, we come to John's Gospel in the chapter 1, and we see here that it was Andrew, his brother, who brought him to where Jesus was. For in John's Gospel in the chapter 1, we read together in the verse 40, and it says there, "One of the 12 which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, We have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, Thou art Simon the son of Jonas, thou shalt be called Cephas, which is by interpretation a stone." And so here, as he's brought to the Lord Jesus, as Andrew testifies of their finding the Messiah, that is the Christ, Peter is brought, and he becomes numbered amongst these 12 disciples. And in both the Gospels of Matthew and indeed John, we see that throughout the days that Peter spent with the Lord Jesus Christ here on earth, that he it was who was singled out many times to receive particular or specific instruction from the Lord, or indeed heard those moments of private conversation that the Lord was involved in. We don't have time this evening to consider them all, but let's come to one chapter that deals very particularly with this in John's Gospel in the chapter 21. John's Gospel in the chapter 21, and let's read together from the verse 1 of the chapter. It tells us the first day, that's John's Gospel, and I'm in chapter 20. Let's come across to chapter 21. It says, "After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and in this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter said unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, We also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing." Now note there again, a clear indicator that Simon Peter is a leader amongst these disciples. He's one who is regarded, he's one who's looked up to, he's the initiator of many of the things that they're involved in, many of the things that they participate in. And here, again, he initiates this fishing trip, and he seemed to be the one standing forth before them, guiding them, perhaps even leading them to go and embark upon this fishing time. Bible tells us then in verse 4, "When the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said unto them, Children, have ye any meat? They answered him, No. And he said unto them, Cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fishes. Therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, It is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher's coat unto him, for he was naked, and did cast himself into the sea." Now come down to verse 15. "So when they had dined," of course the fish are all gathered up, they come back to the shore, the Lord says unto them, "Come and dine." But as they're spending that time with the Lord Jesus Christ, this resurrected Savior, and we come to verse 15. "So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto them, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith to him again," that's Simon Peter, again the second time, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep." And here we see once again, as has been the case right throughout the earthly ministry of Christ, the Lord addressing Peter specifically, imparting to him instruction, seeking to build him up, seeking to guide him, seeking to instill within him the key principles that would be required and necessary for continuing the gospel ministry after the Lord Jesus Christ's work here on earth had been accomplished. And so we know, of course, that shortly after, and this time of breakfast there by the seaside, this time once again that Peter has received specific instruction that he is to go forth and feed the sheep, he is to go forth and impart the gospel, he is to go forth and preach and teach that which he has received of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord ascends to be with his Father, and what happens? the disciples tarry. They know what it is to be found in the upper room. And once again, Peter takes the lead, for in that upper room, he it is who initiates the replacement process that the disciples become involved in to find a new replacement for Judas amongst their number. And then going forth from that room after the Holy Ghost has fallen upon them, who stands before the men and women of Jerusalem and preaches? Peter. And he it is who is also found there in the early chapters of Acts, the early days of the New Testament church, after it's been empowered by the Holy Ghost. We see that he is the one who indeed is involved in miracles, the performance of miracles. He it is with John who goes to the temple to pray. They met a lame man on the way, the little chorus goes. And of course, we know that that lame man went walking and leaping and praising God. Why? Because Peter spake unto him, and that power that was invested in him by the Holy Ghost of God himself allowed Peter to see that lame man rise up and walk. And such was the presence of God in his life. Such was the clear evidence of the presence of God in his life, that Peter stood head and shoulders above the others. He was a preacher of prominence. He was a leader among men. And he was, of course, the disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, tradition tells us that Peter would go on to preach and to teach the gospel in many lands, and we believe that to be true. And then also, well, there's no biblical evidence to it, but tradition would tell us that Peter ended up being crucified just as the Lord was, and requested, of course, to be crucified upside down because he felt not worthy to be crucified in the same manner as his Savior was. Now, we can't prove that from Scripture, but nevertheless, we would attest to that idea, of course, that Peter was faithful throughout the remainder of his life. He it was, remember, who denied the Lord Jesus Christ. He was one who said, "I'll be with you right to the death." And what happened? He denied him. "Are you one of his followers?" "No, not me." Three times. And then the cock crew. But nevertheless, the Lord gave him that second chance, reestablished him there in the gospel ministry. And he went forth and was faithful unto the death as he served the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the character of Peter. We come to consider then the character of James. James is one of the sons of Zebedee, John being the other, and we'll come to consider John in just a few moments. James is also one of the sons of thunder. This was a term that the Lord Jesus Christ used to describe both he and his brother John. Now some, of course, would suggest that it was a term of rebuke, but nevertheless, it's also used, I believe, as a term of affection because, yes, their characters, both James and John, were combustible. And thereby, the Lord Jesus Christ referred to them as being the sons of thunder. But nevertheless, these were two key disciples amongst that group of men who followed and who worked and who served and who labored with the Lord Jesus Christ here on earth. It's true to say that out of these three disciples, James is perhaps the least well known. He's also the one that the Bible does not contain very much information about. He always appears really to be in the shadow of his brother John, that more prominent one of the two. But his place in the list of disciples is always second to Peter. And I believe that is a clear suggestion that James was another disciple of prominence. He was another disciple of importance, and he was a leader as well among the disciples. And that's why I suggest that this is true then, that his name is found second in the list of disciples as we read it very often in the Word of God. Now, he was one who lived up, no doubt, to his reputation as being a son of thunder. He was passionate. He was zealous. He was fervent. He was one who was undoubtedly outspoken. He was one who was intense, and indeed he was impatient. And all the scripture records that are ascribed to him truly testify of that. Remember, he was the one who suggested that the fire be called down from heaven upon those who were not willing to receive Christ, who were not willing to receive the message of Christ. He desired that they be consumed by fire immediately in the moment. He is also one of the two who lobbied for that seat of prominence in the coming kingdom. He asked for that seat to be on the right hand of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we see one who is fervent, one who is zealous, one who is impatient, one who is outspoken. He's intense in all he does, but nevertheless, he is a faithful follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come across to Acts Gospel in the chapter 12, and we see the important place that he holds in the early days of the New Testament church, because he is one of the disciples who is martyred in the early days of the New Testament church. Such is his faithful stand before the Lord Jesus Christ that he finds himself slain because of his faith. Now, no doubt as well that attests to the truth that he is a combustible character. He is one who is outspoken, perhaps rubs people up easily the wrong way, made some enemies. And the Bible tells us here that at that time, in chapter 12 of the book of Acts, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. And he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. And we know, of course, Peter's released, but here James, the record, tells us he's slain because he is a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, because he is a preacher of the gospel. And remember, these are the days in the book of Acts whenever that gospel is being rejected by the Jews. It's being worked against by those Judaizers and others who see how it's becoming a mainstay among the people, how it's having effect in the people's lives, how it's building the numbers of this early New Testament church. And James suffers for his faith. James suffers because he is that faithful follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, James and John both are the sons of Zebedee. We don't know much about Zebedee, but we know enough to understand that Zebedee was a successful man. He was a well-known man. He was a man of prominence even there in Galilee. And indeed, he had a fishing business. James and John were involved in it. Whenever the Lord Jesus Christ came unto them and called them to follow him, leave their nets and follow after him. But there was also others involved. So this was a successful business. It was a business that employed other people also. And therefore, we understand that these two sons of Zebedee, these two individuals, James and John belonged to a family of renown, and they were prominent even there within their local community. So we come to consider John, the other son of Zebedee, the other son of thunder. And the Bible tells us something very specific about John, and that helps us also understand the standing of Zebedee in the local community and indeed amongst the Jewish people wider, because John, the Bible tells us, was known of the high priest. And some would suggest this is why Peter then found himself in the courtyard where the Lord Jesus Christ had been taken to stand before the high priest. This is why he was warming his hands at the fire. This is why these questions were asked to him, because John had that access to get him in to the inside, because Peter was seeking to remain true to his vow. He'd be with him to the death. He'd defend him. He'd seek to liberate him. He'd seek to stand for him. And we could know, of course, that when the moment came that he denied him. But John is recorded in Scripture as being known by the high priest, and once again helps us understand that Zebedee, their father, is a successful man, well known, and because of that his sons also are well known in Galilee, well known amongst the Jewish community, but now they're followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And John, of course, is the disciple whom we refer to as being the one whom Jesus loved. And his gospel, the gospel record, according to John, is filled with terms of affinity. It's filled with terms of affection, even in those moments that he shared with the Lord Jesus Christ. We know at one occasion he's there in the bosom of the Lord Jesus Christ, suggesting, of course, that nearness, that closeness, how, of course, he loved him, how he sought to faithfully live for him and serve for him. And John goes on to be, of course, a well-regarded disciple. He, we believe, is the disciple who lives the longest after the Lord Jesus Christ has ascended to be with his Father. And he writes the gospel according to John. He writes the three epistles of John. And he writes also the book of Revelation. Now, the character of John is one that we've considered a little bit whenever we studied 1 John. And we saw there how he's very direct in his writings, how he doesn't pull any punches. And for him, many subject areas are simply black and white. There's no gray. You and I come to things sometimes and we say, it's not just as easy as this or that. It's not just as easy as right or wrong. It's not just as easy or yes and no. But with John, it always was. And he wore his heart on his sleeve, because as he wrote his gospel record, he said very clearly that as he wrote the words of John's gospel, he was writing them that you and I might believe that Jesus was the Son of God, and not believing, we might have life through his name. And of course, that was his desire, writing the gospel, that we would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, that we would come to love the Lord Jesus Christ just as he did. and the epistles of John, he states clearly again his mandate, why he's writing. Why is it? So that we might be sure we know that the Lord Jesus Christ is our Savior and that we love him with all of our hearts. And so he's very clear in his intent. He's very clear in his purposes. And he is unashamedly standing for what he believes in. And he doesn't care what anybody else thinks. He speaks the truth and he speaks it directly. And yes, he seeks to speak it in love also. And then, of course, we come to the book of Revelation. And why does he write the book of Revelation? He writes the book of Revelation so we might be ready, so we can know the signs that point to the return of the Lord and how imminent it is and how time will progress and lead up to that great climax of the world, that great climax of time itself, the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ again, the second time, coming to this earth, not in mercy, not in grace, but in judgment, to judge and to make war with the heathen nations, the ungodly believers, and to establish that millennium kingdom in which the believers and indeed the Jewish people shall hold that place of prominence even there with the Lord. And so we see he believes everything's absolute. He believes, of course, that the Lord Jesus Christ and his word is to be completely obeyed and applied in his life. Now, as we come to consider the character of John, he is one who most certainly matures as his time with the Lord Jesus Christ progresses. And that allows him then to be developed into that great apostle who would write key, significant, and prominent literature there in his epistles and indeed in the book of Revelation. But we see how the Lord even recognizes his maturity and indeed how he is growing in his knowledge of the Lord and his love for the Lord. For as we come to the time of crucifixion, come across to John's Gospel in the chapter 19. Read with me in the verse 25. It tells us, there at the foot of the cross stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleophas and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, we believe that to be most definitely John, the disciple, he said unto him, he saith unto, his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then he saith to the disciple, behold thy mother. And so we entrust John, that disciple who loved the Lord Jesus Christ, but that disciple also whom Scripture records Jesus loved. And it says, from that hour the disciple took her, that's his mother, he entrusted his mother into the care of John. And from that hour, John took Mary, the mother, earthly mother of the Lord Jesus Christ, onto his own home. He loved her as his own. He cared for her. He provided for her. He protected her as long as he could. And this was a duty. This was a responsibility that was bestowed upon him by the Lord Jesus Christ. And so coming to consider these three characters, we've taken an extended time there to lay the introduction as to who these men are, the significance of truly their characters, the place that they held amongst the disciples, and indeed as the days progressed into the early New Testament church. And therefore that, I believe, helps us to better understand even these moments that they spend with the Lord Jesus Christ here in the Mount of Transfiguration. For as we've considered these three men, I want us to notice then quickly three points. Three points that testify of their being witnesses to something in the life of the Savior, and indeed witnesses that we can believe in about the ministry of the Savior. And the first thing that I want us to notice is simply this. They were witnesses to the Master's appeal. They were witnesses to the Master's appeal because these were three men who were called of the Lord Jesus Christ. And indeed, as we know, Peter was brought by Andrew. Why did he come? He came because Andrew himself attested to the fact, we have found Messiah. There's something about this man. Peter, you need to come and see him. Peter, you need to come and behold him. There's something different about this one. Truly, he must be the Christ. We know that James and John were involved there, mending their nets, washing their nets, sitting by the seaside, and the Lord Jesus Christ passed by, and he said, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. And the same hour they rose up, left everything behind, and followed him. And that is testimony to the appeal of the Master. That is the testimony to the appeal of the Lord Jesus Christ. For here were three individuals who were willing to leave everything behind, and indeed to follow the Lord Jesus Christ wherever he went. Their love for him only ever grew. We have noted already how that John is that one who loved the Lord Jesus Christ and who Scripture tells us is the one whom the Lord Jesus Christ loved in return. We saw how that Peter is one who is willing to stake all upon his defense of the Lord Jesus Christ, can risk his very life to defend the Lord Jesus Christ. And oh yes, he lets him down. Oh yes, he feels in that moment whenever the test is at its most severe, but nevertheless, he desires up until this point to be one who defends the Lord, one who stands for the Lord, and one who will not allow any harm to be brought to the Lord. And even in James's representations for having a seat at the right hand of the Christ in the new kingdom, we see again testimony to the appeal. He wanted to be close. He recognized that the one whom he followed, the one whom he served, was indeed the promised Messiah of Christ and one who would establish a kingdom here on earth, one who would rule and reign the nations in righteousness. And all the time they are testimony to and witnesses to the appeal of the Master. Tonight, if you're a believer, are you not also that same witness? Can you not also see and identify in Christ that which is most certainly appealing? For he it is who is the only way of salvation. He it is who is faithful to every promise that he has ever made. And he it is who will be faithful to those promises that are yet to be. And truly, as we reflect on what he has promised to us, what lies ahead for us, what is it? It is that promise of a home in heaven. It is that promise that as he has ascended to be with his Father, so he shall come in like manner and receive his own to be with him. And we are looking forward to spending those times here serving him, ruling and reigning with him here on earth. But then in the heavens to come, we look forward even to that time whenever we shall be employed in his service, employed in his worship, employed in that song of the redeemed, testifying of the fact that he is one who is appealing above all else, above everyone else. Oh, the hymn writer put it this way: take the world, but give me Jesus. And surely in that thought he is identifying that Jesus outshines all the wonders and the glories of this world. Jesus outshines even the very people of this world. And come to consider the testimony there of the disciples in the Mount of Transfiguration. And the Bible tells us that he bringeth them apart up on high mountain in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 17. And was transfigured and his face did shine as the sun. There's nothing brighter in our world that is known than the sunlight. Oh, you and I can look into the light of bulbs and torches and headlamps, and we can bear it, we can put up with it for so long. And yes, some of those lights are of such power and such degree that we have to turn away. But truly, looking at the sun is something that is beyond our human capability, for we can damage our eyesight, and the closer we get to it, the brighter it shines, the more damage it can do. Such is the radiance, such is even the light that is emanated forth from the sun. But here the Lord Jesus Christ is transfigured, and he is transfigured to the point that his face did shine as the sun. His raiment was as white as the light. And there we have one who is incomprehensible. For you and I cannot comprehend one whose glory is manifested even in such a way as it was there in the Mount of Transfiguration. But in all things, they witness to the appeal of the Lord. Not only are they witnesses to the Master's appeal, but as we come to consider this Transfiguration account, they are witnesses to his awesome glory. They are witnesses to his awesome glory. Now, as we reflect upon the truth that is recorded for us here in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 17, and indeed in Mark's Gospel in the chapter 9, and it's also recorded in Luke's Gospel and the chapter 9 as well. But this is all against the backdrop of how the Lord has already appeared to his people. Remember, these three men, and indeed the other disciples, are Jewish by descent. They know what it is to be raised and educated well in the Word of God that has been revealed up until this point. And that Word would have most certainly recorded how that God had appeared to his people many times throughout their history. But all the appearances of the Lord came in the form of bright light. You consider how he was revealed even in the days of the children of Israel. He went before them, what? In a burning fire, a pillar of fire by night. cloud, yes, by day, but a burning pillar of fire by night. And as, of course, we come to the time whenever Moses is there upon the mount receiving the commandments, the fire of the Lord came down, the smoke ascended, again light testifying of the presence of the Lord. We know of the days of the consecration of the temple, again, the Lord appears in the form of light. Light is always to be associated with the appearances of the Lord up until this point. And here before the eyes of these three disciples, the appearance of the incarnate Son of God changed before their eyes. They had been with the Lord Jesus Christ many days before this. They had spent that time. They recognized who he was. They truly knew his appearance. There was nothing about him that would have surprised them. Here before their eyes, he was transfigured. And this is a moment, truly, when it is as if the humanity of his flesh was simply pulled away and his glory shone through. Now remember, God the Son appeared in flesh, but he was fully God at all times and fully man. He didn't lay aside any part of his deity. What he did lay aside in coming to earth and taking on flesh, what he did lay aside was the free expression of his glory. He was at all times, as he spent those 33 years here on earth, he was always coexistent, co-eternal, and co-equal with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. He was always all-powerful. He was always all-knowing. And indeed, as we come to consider all the attributes of God, he was holy, he was righteous, he was wisdom, he was truth, he was love. All the things that you and I ascribe as being attributes of God, characteristics of God, they were found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. But what was laid aside temporarily for those 33 years was the expression of the manifestation of his glory. But only here in the Mount of Transfiguration do we get a glimpse of that glory. And it is as if the veil of humanity is pulled aside. And before the eyes of these three men, they beheld the glory of Christ that one day you and I shall behold if we know and love him as our Lord and Savior. One day our faith shall become sight, and we shall look upon the Lamb, and we shall look upon our Savior, and we shall see him in the glory and the majesty on high. Oh, that's a brilliant day to look forward to. That's a high water day to look forward to. But here, as the disciples are taking up this mountain, as the Lord is transfigured before them, this is confirmation that he is the Son of God. This is confirmation of all that is to come. But it also, remember, is that reminder of what he laid aside, the free expression of his glory as he came to live and minister here on earth. What a moment. These three disciples are face to face with the Savior. Nothing dimming their view. Remember, you and I look, as it were, through a glass, but it's dim. It's dim. We haven't yet beheld the brightness of his glory. But John was the one, of course, who wrote in the Gospel according to John. Come across to John's Gospel in the chapter 1. And he records these words. And remember, this is the gospel begins, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was what was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And this is, remember, a passage which is a fundamental passage which proves, of course, the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. But as well as that, John goes on to say in the verse, let's read from verse 11. He came unto his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them give he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe in his name, which were born not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That's what we identify. God the Son, here on earth, in flesh. But then he goes on to say, we beheld his glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Father. And truly only John, only James, and only Peter could write that and know what it was to have proof of that, because they were the ones who experienced, they were witnesses, they were eyewitnesses to a manifestation, that time of the manifestation of his glory here on earth, this time whenever he was transfigured before their eyes. And so with overwhelming truth, he writes these words, we beheld. He could rightly say, I beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And this was a moment that he became a witness to his awesome glory, and it changed his life forever. Face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be when with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me. Oh, I'm jealous of John. I'm jealous of James. I'm jealous of Peter. Why? Because they beheld the Savior in all his glory. And oh, I look forward to that day whenever I shall see him, and whenever I too shall be a witness, an eyewitness of the glory of the risen, exalted Lamb, the one who loved me, the one who died for me. Oh, these three men were witnesses to the Master's appeal. They were witnesses to his awesome glory. But then number three, they were witnesses to the Savior's agony. Now, this time in the Mount of Transfiguration, it all happens as the Lord begins to turn the minds of the disciples and the understanding of the disciples to what lies ahead. That time, whenever he shall know what it is to be crucified and taken at the hands of cruel men and there laid upon a cross of wood in order that he might give his life a ransom for all. And verse 21 of the chapter 16 of the book of Matthew, the word of God records, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders, of the chief priests, and of the scribes, and be killed and raised again the third day. Now, what has happened to prompt this is, of course, that he has said unto them in the verse 13, he says unto his disciples, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? They said in verse 14, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it, and I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time, so whenever they recognized and identified that he was the promised Messiah, but of course their Jewish expectation of the Messiah was that he would come and establish a political kingdom, that he would come and be a political savior. But Christ here begins to show unto his disciples how that the purpose, the reason for his coming was not to establish a political kingdom, but to purchase salvation full and free so that all who believe might enter into that knowledge of the promise of God in Christ. What is it? A home in heaven and indeed being part of the family of God. And that anticipation then, whenever he shall return, a kingdom truly will be established. And those who have believed in him, those who have accepted of the offer of salvation that he purchased by his own death and the shedding of his own blood, they shall rule and they shall reign with him. And so these three men have been part of this discussion, how that Christ is beginning to unfold even that great plan and that drama of redemption, how that is going to culminate in him giving of his life, being taken by cruel men, and there being offered as a sacrifice unto God upon that cross. He willingly gave of his life a sacrifice for sin. But Peter tells us in verse 22 of chapter 16, took him, began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. Remember, Peter was fervent in his defense of the Lord, and he sought to practically and physically defend the Lord. But this all points to the truth that at this moment, Peter doesn't fully comprehend nor understand what the plan of God is in Christ. He is anticipating, just as he has been educated to do in the Jewish system, in the Jewish law, according to Jewish scriptures, to anticipate a political kingdom. He doesn't recognize a spiritual provision that is in Christ and will be found in Christ as Christ offers his life there upon the cross, a payment for sin. The Lord rebukes him and says, get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me. For thou savourest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. And then this is all followed by the Lord taking the disciples up into the high mountain apart. Just these three disciples, Peter, James, and John. And the Lord begins again, even through this experience here upon the Mount of Transfiguration, to testify to them of what lies ahead. And at this point, they are further witnesses of the agony of the Savior. For as they're there upon that mountain, he was transfigured, and behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. So here comes the appearance not only of the Lord Jesus Christ in all the fullness of his glory, but also Elijah and Moses. Elijah, remember, testifies to us of the prophets. Moses testifies to us of the law. And Christ is communicating that message even as they commune with the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's communicating that message to the three disciples that he will be that one who satisfies the demands of the law, who fulfills the words of the prophets. Now, some have asked what is the conversation perhaps about between Moses, Elias, and the Lord. And I suggest to you that it's not beyond the realms of possibility that it was all about his death. All about that which was to come. They were not anticipating a political kingdom just as the disciples were. They recognized, being on the other side, of course, they recognized and identified that the fulfillment of all that they knew in their time, Moses only knowing the law, and yes, of course, being privy to some of the early prophecies of the coming Messiah, but Elijah being privy to very many of the prophecies of the coming Messiah, now being on the other side, they were privy to the full details of the plan of God. And they knew that the purpose for which Christ was upon earth was that he would fulfill the law, he would fulfill the words of prophecy, he would give his life to purchase salvation full and free. But Peter again testifies of his unbelief, his unwillingness to believe, his incapacity to believe. For it says in verse 4, he says, Lord, it's good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, one for Elias. I know Peter, again, he's just testifying to that anticipation of a kingdom. Remember, Elias was to come before the coming Messiah, and he perhaps thought to himself, if we tabernacle Moses here, if we tabernacle Jesus here, and if we tabernacle Elijah here, and the people behold this, then this will usher in the kingdom and we can get started straight away. But that was never the plan of God. And whenever he utters those words, and sometimes Peter reminds us of the truth that sometimes it's better to say nothing. If we don't fully comprehend or understand what's going on, sometimes it's better just to keep it shut. But in verse 5, the word of God tells us, while he yet spake, that's why Peter's babbling here, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. A further confirmation of the deity of Christ, a further confirmation that he was truly Messiah, the promised one of God. But then he also says, this voice also says, the voice of God says to Peter, especially in that moment, hear ye him. Peter, listen, all along the Lord Jesus Christ has begun to testify and reveal to you, even from the chapter previous, he's beginning to open the mind of your understanding to the fact he's not here to deliver a political kingdom. He's here to purchase salvation. He's here to fulfill the plan of God, and he's here to fulfill the great plan of redemption. Peter, hear him. Listen. Because you are not only to be a witness of the appeal of the Master, you're not only to be a witness of the awesome glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, but you are to be a witness to the agony, because that will be the message that you go forward with, that the Lord Jesus Christ suffered upon the cross, and he fulfilled the plan of God, and he purchased the salvation full and free. Peter, that is your message. Listen, take it all in. When the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, arise, be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And when, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. Why? Because this will validate the message. This will be a core component of the message. That all along Christ was here to fulfill the plan of God. And you three, you're eyewitnesses to it. And oh, the message that you will deliver, oh, the message that you will be able to preach is a message that will stand true and will stand fast and will stand up to scrutiny. Why? Because the law will be have been fulfilled in my finished work. The prophecies will have been fulfilled in my finished work. And all along, the plan of God will be now apparent. How that the Old Testament scriptures only ever pointed forward to Christ, and how I have come to fulfill the law, the prophecies, the entire word of God. So there are eyewitnesses indeed to the Savior's agony. Now you come across to Mark's Gospel in the chapter 14. For that their opportunity to be eyewitnesses to this, those three men didn't stop on the Mount of Transfiguration. For they, of course, continued with the other 12 during the remainder of the earthly ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. But all the while, the road that they were treading with the Savior, it was only ever going to Jerusalem. It was only ever going to Golgotha. And in chapter 14, we come to the Passover. We come to the Last Supper that they spend there with the Lord Jesus Christ. And then they leave from the upper room. In verse 26, when they had sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. And Jesus saith unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. Peter said unto him, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. Again, Peter is not fully understanding of all that's unfolding before him. Yes, he's been an eyewitness to the appeal of the Master. Yes, he's been an eyewitness to his awesome glory. But he has yet to learn the further lessons required so that he might be that complete eyewitness to the Savior's agony. And the Lord turns to him and says, verily I say unto thee that this day, even in this night, before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. But he spake the more vehemently, if I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all. They came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he saith to his disciples, sit ye here while I shall pray. And he taketh with him Peter and James and John, and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. Now listen, in your mind's eye, picture this. There's the disciples there. There's only now, of course, eight of them. And they're left in a little huddle. They're left in a little group. And he says, watch and pray. And he takes with him Peter, James, and John. And they go a little further with the Lord. And then he leaves them there too. And then he goes a little distance from them. But all the while he's in their eyesight. All the while they are beholding what is occurring. And yes, we know, of course, that as he prays and as he toils in prayer, that they end up sleeping and he comes and rebukes him. But at that moment, as he gets down on his knees, they are no doubt beholding the agony of the Savior, how that his body is indeed filled with that passion. Because he knows what is lying before him. He's sweating the great drops of blood. He's crying unto the Lord. He's praying with that great, high priestly prayer. And indeed, he's wrestling with the very will of God in that moment. And they're beholding it. Again, those three are taken a little farther to behold the agony of the Savior. To behold that great moment in the Garden of Gethsemane where he submits, fully submits to the Father's will. And this, I believe, further cements their ability to be eyewitnesses to the Savior's agony. And then beholding on the cross, of course, we know all the disciples there are found. Some stand afar off, but they're beholding the Savior crucified. And they're seeing the agony that he's in. They're hearing the cries, I thirst. They're hearing the cries of the Savior, even as he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They're hearing the cries of the Savior as he then bows the head and he says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my Lord, why hast thou forsaken me? And with one final cry, it is finished. And they behold it. And this is further building blocks in their experience with the Lord and helps to cement and validate that truth in their own lives. And these three go forth and they're witnesses to the Savior's appeal. They're witnesses to his awesome glory. They're witnesses to the Savior's agony. Tell me tonight, what kind of witness are you? Are you truly one who can rightly and accurately describe the appeal of the Lord? Are you one who is able, yes, indeed, to convey some idea of the glory of the Lord? Are you one who testifies and witnesses of the agony of the Lord? We too are to be witnesses. And from the lives and from the experiences of these three men, we are reminded that we have a completed canon of Scripture. We have a completed revelation of Jesus Christ in our hands. And we are to go forth and to preach and to teach Jesus. Him alone. He is the only way of salvation, and He is to be our only message. Tell me, what kind of witness are you? Yes, both of these three men remind us that you do not need to be a perfect individual to serve the Lord, because you can never be. God isn't looking for perfect vessels. He's looking for those who are yielded, submitted to Him. Those who have experienced for themselves the truth of His message, and those who have instilled within them the very reason that we should go forth and tell. That should be our motivation, because we are witnesses to all that He has done for us. I pray that God will help us all truly to speak of Him more, to speak of Him better, and to present Him, the crucified, risen, exalted Savior of the world. And may God use us to truly impact and influence the lives of others. May God bless His word to our hearts tonight. Father, we thank and we praise Thee for all that Thy word communicates to us in the lives of Peter, James, and John. And Lord, we had much more to say, and indeed we needed to say much more, but Lord, we leave it with Thee. And we pray that that which has been said will truly be that which is of Thee. And we pray, our Lord, that Thou wouldst be pleased to communicate Thy truth to each of our hearts, and that we may see and behold our Savior, the risen, exalted One, and that our lives would be those steadfast witnesses of all that He has done for us, and that we would proclaim the truth that what He has done for us, so too He can do for others. Lord, give us that desire, give us that zeal, give us that fervency within, and help us to yield ourselves even to Thy way and to Thy service. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If I told you my story, thank you. the time.